So not only from an organization perspective, today, as Infosys BPO, I have trained more than 120,000 graduates to transition from campus to corporate. When I say this, what we do differently is that we have a program called Project Genesis, where we get professors from different colleges coming into a campus for 50 days. We expose them to 180-hour module in terms of what is it they can go back to their colleges and train their students. So that, say, a person from Tinsukia or Chuchikoran or Gurdaspur or wherever stand a better chance when they compete with people from metros. On a different platform, you also have the center in Mysore, which looks at training differently. And people who've seen this, there were Faisal guys here, will vouch for what happens there. And opportunities in terms of mergers and acquisitions, the way we go about positioning the right person in that right role are things which we look into. Ultimately, each one of us is guided by certain numbers. I can talk from an HR perspective. The numbers which guide me are 45, 70 and 25. 45 stands for a position to be filled in, irrespective of a CEO or a personal entry level. Of course, there are gradings, but an average time to fill a position for me is 45 days. 70 is a target for me in terms of seeing growth from within, opportunities for people to grow within the organization. And the utopian target of 25 is in terms of retention attrition. The industry is at 35, 38, 40% in terms of attrition, and I've been told that it needs to be at 25%. So each of the business leaders has certain metrics to ensure. Business leaders have a metric of ensuring 25% margin. We are at about 21-22% at this point of time. So ultimately, I think this industry is hugely metric driven. It is not just that we need to follow some SLA. The fact is that every one of our actions and deliverables is driven by numbers. And the fact is, as an organization, I think we provide enough space. It is just not Infosys platforms. We have systems called the binding tree, where we call experts from different walks of life, like how you have a series like this, where a person comes from out and spends about a couple of hours here. We have experts, whether it's the social crusaders, educationalists, industry veterans, teachers, who come in and spend a couple of hours every month in our campuses, comes under the brand of Banyan Tree. Newcomers have a mentorship program called Guru. And more than that, the way we look at it is just not company-centric. At NASCOM, I have downloaded, I was telling Professor Rajiv this morning, 180 hours of my training content to NASCOM, which provides graduates to prepare themselves better to join the industry. So ultimately, for an organization, for you to continue your career, it becomes that much more critical that you look at it from an overall perspective, take it forward. While there are enough and more programs in terms of what we do, I think guys who come in for placements would be a lot specific in terms of what we do. All the acronyms which you see here are the different interventions which we undertake in terms of junior management and leadership program, or in terms of internal job postings. Club Fuel is Future Emerging Leaders after the laterals, where we do, we get coaches from outside to help them develop their 2-year career map and things like that. Ultimately, the way I would look at it is that when you choose your career, you need to be absolutely sure. It means your aspirations in terms of domain and the knowledge which you should be getting and contributing at one end. And two, is it giving you the right ladder or lattice in terms of way you move in your careers? This is how I would look at in terms of growth for you and giving an exposure of not only the industry but also in terms of a career. I told you that I'll show the latest building of Mysore. You had not seen this building. You have seen only the phase one, this is phase two. This is the latest building in Mysore, which is having a capacity. If it's a single occupancy, it can accommodate at any given point of time 13,500 students. But if it's twin sharing, it will be 27,000 people at one point. This is how the campus is in Mysore. The way I would look at it is that I'm awestruck every time I get into the campus after 5 years. I've seen different industry segments, verticals, worked in four other organizations. Probably this is one company which walks the talk. Definitely we have our own shortcomings. But the fact is, working in four different organizations, I believe that whether it's in terms of an organization or more importantly from a career perspective, the BPA, I think, is something which people are now beginning to take seriously. So my sincere request is that while there are organizations and there are sectors, there are verticals which people would need to consider, I would strongly suggest, recommend, don't get taken in by what is spoken or shown, but do your own research. Whether it's in terms of an industry or the organization one would like to get associated with, I think that is what will make a difference. I think I will stop talking here because this is more internal to the organization. For us, GDP is not what you understand. GDP is growth, differentiation, and people is the mantra with which we follow. And the GDP is now converted to 3 R's, not reading, writing, and arithmetic. It is relevance, respect, and reach as an organization. And this is what each one of us in our scorecards have imbibed in. And I would look at for each one of you to be looking when as you grow in your career to ensure these 3 R's are not forgotten. That you continue to be relevant in the field you would like to be. And because of your relevance and being up to date and delivering, you increase your respect. And once you're respected, your reach, whether in terms of opportunities or being called for, becomes a lot better. With this, I would like to conclude my formal presentation. I would be a lot more comfortable if this now becomes interactive for you to ask your questions. Thank you.
Lock, stock, and barrel, the model was to move it to a third party
to a developing country. Because the returns they got out of it was 5-6 times than what it would have happened to their country in that same place which they were operating. Say in the US, they moved into India, it was unimaginable, the profits. So they milked the profits, say, for 3 to 4 years. But after that, the growth is incremental. So then businesses think that do I continue to outsource the way we were outsourcing in the past, or move to another geography like Rwanda, where it is cheaper? That's first. But I think the business model today is changing from being cheaper to a value-added. So in addition to being economical, is it adding more value, is what businesses need. Then came the model of where you say, you take over a captive. Let me focus in the business of doing, I suppose I'm Ford. Let me focus on manufacturing cars. The rest of the processes let me outsource. So the captives started being bought over. That's how we bought over Philips as a company. Three is in terms of businesses also look at a one-stop shop to get it. But as a company, I may not have all the expertise. And that's where I buy over companies. And that's where the onshore model comes into place. Where it's more difficult for me to set up operations when I don't have the skill set. I would rather have a company that is operating there, take it on, except for the high value-added businesses which I will continue there. The routine, repetitive tasks then gets into a low-cost economy. And Captus is another place where I want to say that I still have my own company, I have my own jobs, and I retain it as such. Even Captus are a cyclical business. Once it becomes unviable, it is given to a third party. And then once third parties bring in a lot of simplicity and take away the drudgery, they take back the businesses. That's how the cycle goes. So there's no one shoe size fits all. It works on the way what makes sense to the business which wants to outsource. That's the way businesses are.
So, I have the next question. First of all, just out of curiosity, I wanted to know that it was named earlier as Progeon. So what happened to the name Progeon? And the second question is, like, Infosys was restructured under the leadership of Shibula into 3.0 model. What was the model basically Infosys BPO was at the same time? And what were the different components in that model?
Okay. Progeon to BPO, Infosys BPO was when the subsidiary was set up. My understanding, I don't know the official reason because I'm very young in the organization, only 5 years young in the BPO ecosystem. But I think traditionally IT industry, I don't know if it's true to BPO, this is my research prior to Infosys. So let me make that disclaimer here. IT generally believed that there will be higher order, higher value adding business. And BPO is always considered low end. And that's why quite a few organizations kept two different entities in terms of the way the industry was run. That, I think, is the reason as an outsider I look at. But once I came in, there are other nuances, I think, which could be more relevant. One is it was a venture, with joint venture with Citibank. Progeon was a joint venture between Citibank and Infosys. So it thought of a name. Progeon, I think, is a Greek god or something. I'm not too sure. And it had a certain meaning. And it developed a good brand by itself. But the minute Citi moved out, probably the thought process was Infosys is a very, very strong brand. And they need to be seen as one entity over all other considerations. And that's why the change from Progeon to Infosys BPO, where we thought we can leverage, and it has helped us a lot. The Progeon, the first 100 employees to believe Progeon was a great brand. But in hindsight, I think the Infosys brand, in terms of naming it, Infosys BPO has helped the organization a lot. And you asked about the question, I missed that part.
Yeah, that's all. Like, we moved earlier to the model of 3.0, right? So what was the same model which was included into the Infosys BPO set as well? Like, what we did was into the vertical scene, move the whole organization. So was there a single kind of change in the BPO sector as well for that?
differently. Infosys BPO, though, is a 100% owned company of Infosys Limited. I think the business model is slightly different, though we try to mirror what the parent does. I don't think they are bound by the apron strings or whatever the parent goes through. Because the business model itself is totally different, where you should be in line with what the customer wants. So to that extent, while the principles of 3.0 for me, I think that's where we looked at the scam in terms of social, cloud, analytics, and mobility. The fact is that the BPO operations today is looking at differently. Even before NASSCOM this year has christened BPO as BPA, the work that we at Infosys do is what BPM is emphasizing. We were the early movers in terms of focusing on domain, leveraging technology, use of platforms, which what the BPM is supposed to do. It's no more just process operations and process management. And therefore, in my view, 3.2 or no 3.2, I think we are ahead of the curve in terms of the way the industry is.
Good morning, sir. My question is, as you mentioned that recently Philippines has taken over India to become number one in BPM industry.
Not the BPM industry, the
concept. Okay, BPM industry. So what is the concept. Okay. So what is the way forward for Indian call center industry? And if the strategy is to move up the value chain, then how you are going to differentiate yourself from the BPM and other IT industry?
Call center is a subset of the entire BPM industry, and it is not an industry by itself, but a subset. And by definition, a call center is supposed to be low value added, though it's a very critical component in the overall outsourcing bouquet of services. By itself, it cannot sustain for a longer period of time. For the simple reason, clients will continue to get a lot more technical, a lot more domain focused. Call centers traditionally looked at in hospitality, taking questions, making some reservations, but today I think the industry has moved on. And English not being the natural language like the way Americans speak, the call center industry has moved to the Philippines, which has a very rich English speaking population which is focused to the US. That's how that industry has grown there, and they're picking up very well. And therefore, today, countries like Philippines are leveraging a lot of what we in India is doing in terms of looking at domain. So you have the NASSCOM of Philippines working very closely with India, trying to mimic, mirror, and innovate what is good for them. But in India, we realized that with the tag this industry has as not being the first top of mind choice for e-com and the best so-called articulate English speaking, not wanting to be associated with this call center industry. This industry is still known as a call center industry. We had to innovate and be different. That's why India continues its leadership position with 39% of the global outsourcing industry currently. And that's why we are moving into all the domains which I mentioned, F&A, sourcing and procurement, HR, so sales and engineering. That's the way forward. It has to be a bouquet of services. I cannot say that just because the call center industry's capital has shifted from India to Manila means that India has gone up. It's not. In fact, it's good for the industry. And today, I have a lot of clients coming back to me saying that, can you shift back operations from Philippines back?